All right, team, we got a little less than a minute. So I'll remember we're here to worship too. Let's have some fun. Super excited to get this going. I love Sundays. I really appreciate you guys being here. What's that? So we'll start on camera three. Camera three, you'll be the very first shot just for a couple seconds, and then we're going to get to camera one. Camera one, if you can be looking out for Wendy on the announcement shots. We've got about 15 seconds. I'll count us down. She's on the stage, right? Or somewhere near?
She is going up now.
Perfect. All right, guys.
And you're just waiting on the light.
Five.
Hey, Wendy.
Four.
Get over just a little
three,
bit.
Two, one, zero.
There she is.
Three's up. Stand by one.
Good morning.
One, you're up.
My name is Wendy Lyon. I'm part of the women's ministry here at Christ Chapel. I'm so happy to be here. Did everyone enjoy their extra hour of sleep last night?
Are we stand by graphic?
For those of you in the sanctuary and for those of you joining us on the internet campus, we're so glad you're here with us this morning. We'd love to get to know you a little better. There's a connect card in the seat back in front of you. It looks just like this. Fill that out. This is all private information. We don't share it anywhere. It's just a place for you, for us to get to know you and send you information about us. If you're joining us from the internet campus, there's a link in the chat button. Just click that link. It'll take you straight to the Connect card. And after you fill that out, hit the submit button. So we have a place at the bottom also for prayer requests at the bottom of the Connect card. And that's for everyone. We are a praying church. We would love to come alongside you and pray. So don't forget
to
put those prayer requests.
Why don't you go ahead and be ready for keys and drums?
Internet campus, please include your prayer requests there as well. The holidays are upon us. Thanksgiving and Christmas are a great time to celebrate with your family. But for some of us, it's a time of grief and loss, and it's hard to move through the holidays. We have a morning class for you called Surviving the Holidays. We'd love for you to join us. It's a great way to help you navigate the holidays and find hope through those seasons. Internet campus, if you cannot join us in person, chat with Owen, and he can get you placed in a group. We'll be praying alongside you, but I hope you can join us for Surviving the Holidays.
Not close, but they don't need to be all the way down.
This morning, and we're going to have communion together, but first, let's stand and sing together.
Say by three. Three, you're up.
Straight to the song. This is...
One, get on them. Two, you can. Say by four. Say by one. One, you're up.
Okay, Jala is talking.
Three, four. Four, ready three, ready five, five, ready one, one. Stand by three, three, you're up, stand by six, six, give me Jala, stand by two, two, four, four, ready one, one. Ready five, five, you're out of focus, stand by three, three, you're up, stand by six, six, ready five, five. Ready four, four. Ready one, one. You're up. Stand by three, three. Ready four, four. Ready one, one. Stand by two, two. Five, five. Ready three, three. Stand by six, six. Ready one, one. Ready three, three. Here we go. Four, four. You're up. Keep those moves going. Stand by six, six. Ready three. Real big here, and three. Ready, five. Five's a little dark, Mikey. Stand by one. One, you're up. Stand by four. Four. Ready, six. Six. Stand by three. Three. Ready, five. Five. Stand by four. Four. Ready, three. Three. Ready, six. Six. Stand by one. One, ready four, four, ready three, three. Here we go, one, one, four. Up, hang on, four, four, you're up. Stand by five, five. Stand by three, three. Ready one, one. Ready four, four. Ready six, six, you're up. Stand by three, three. Ready two, two. 25, 5. Stick with them. So 3, 3, ready, 1, 1, ready, 4, 4, ready, 5, 5, ready, 3, or 1, 1, 4, 4, 3, 3, 6, 6 to the right just a little bit, 6, you're up, ready, 3, 3, ready, 1, 1, ready, 5, 5, ready, 4, 4, 2, 2, ready, 3, 3, 1, 1, ready, 6, get it, 6, get it, 6, you're up, ready, 3, 3, you're up, ready, ready, 4, 4, ready, 1, 1, stay by 5, 5, you're up, stay by 3, 3, ready, 4, 4, ready, 1, ready, 6, actually, 6, you're up, ready, 1, 1, 3, 3, you're up, stay by 2, 2, ready, 5, 5, ready, 4, 4, ready, 1, 1, ready, 3, 3, you're up, stay by 6, 6, ready, 2, 2, ready, 5, 5, you're up, ready, 1, 1, stay by 3, 3, ready, 6, 6, ready, 4, 4, ready, 1, 1, 3, 3, ready, 2, actually, ready, 6, 6, ready, 4, 4, you're up, ready, 1, 1, ready, 5, 5, 3, 3, ready, 2, 2, ready, 1, 1, ready, 6, 6, ready, 4, 4, ready, 1, and 1, 3, 3, you're up.
This is Jala.
All right, Jala's going to read scripture here, so give me some chance, Jala, stand by 1, 1 still shot here.
My name is Jala Toss.
1's up.
I'm one of the worship leaders here on staff, and so good.
Stand by 4.
To be able to be with you in the room and those online.
He'll say scripture in
Wait,
Isaiah.
Let's try to get Jala and focus on that one 4.
Come and to sing about a king who's good, who loves us dearly, to sing joy.
He'll say scripture in Isaiah, and that's when.
But I understand, I'm sure you would agree with me in this, there's just times that...
Ready, 4, let's hold it steady, go to the right, right just a little bit.
And it's not always easy to choose joy, so for myself, there's a
scripture in Isaiah. Up. Stand by 6,
that
6,
that's
it.
In this season, as I
scripture.
To remember where my help comes from.
I'm going to wait until he says it, because Rachel asked me to do that.
Okay, that's fine.
And it says, have you not known, have you not
four, you're up, nice and steady
the
here.
The Lord is the everlasting
nice
God,
and steady, nice
creator
and steady.
Of the ends of the
ready,
earth.
3.
He does not faint or grow weary.
3's up.
His understanding is unsearchable.
Ready,
he gives power to the faint, and to him who has no might, he increases strength. Even
one's
youth
up.
Shall faint and be weary, and young men
ready, 6.
Shall fall exhausted. But they who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength.
6's
they
up.
They shall mount up with wings like eagles.
Ready, 33.
They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint.
3.
Honestly, I'm the type of person that I'm always trying to
ready, 4.
Control things. And
4, just
and
put him on the left side there.
Everything
instead
together.
Of center, there you go.
I feel this burden with my family,
4, you're up.
With my role, with these things that I've got to just keep working hard with my two hands.
Ready, 1.
And to be honest, there's so many moments that I feel weary and tired.
1.
And God does not grow faint. He doesn't grow weary. And there's
this is the second song, so 4, make sure you're
so
ready to get to the drums quickly.
Take
stand by 3.
All the things we're carrying that we're burdened with, that we're wearing ourselves out with, and to place them in the hands of the Father.
3's
those
up.
Arms are safe, they're strong, they're
ready, 6.
Secure. And so I think in this moment, as we just continue to worship,
6 is up.
What are the things that you're holding on to, that you're wrestling with, that you're trying so hard, clenching so tight to keep together, that you just
ready,
need to
surrender
to the Lord? And just offer that in this time. Let it be a prayer to him as we just continue to sing.
1's up. Stand by 3. Nice and slow. 3's up. 4, ready, 5. 5. Ready, 4.
This is Kelsey.
Kelsey's singing this song, guys. 4's up. 5, get to the keys. 5, get to the keys quickly. Stay by 3. 3, you're up. Stay by 5. we go. Five, you're up. Ready, one, one. Nice and slow here, Adam. Stand by three. Three. Ready, six.
You understand me.
Six, you're focused a little soft. There you go. Six, you're up. Four, go a little wider on that shot. Oh, he's done. Never mind. Stand by five. Five. Ready, four. Four, you're up. Stand by three. Three. Ready, one. One. Ready, five. Five. Three, or six. Six. Get your focus, six. There you go. Stand by one. One. Ready, five. Five. Ready, four. Four. Stand by three. Three. Ready, one. One. Ready, four. Get to the drums, four. Stand by four. Four, you're up. Five. Five, you're up. Ready, six. Extra, ready, three. Three. Stand by six. Stand by four. Four. Stand by six. Six. Ready, one. One. Ready, two. Two. Ready, three. Three. Ready, six. Let's put her on the left side. Stand by six. Six, you're up. Yeah, four. I like that. Stand by four. Four, you're up. Ready, one. And one. Ready, five. Five. Four. Four. Three. Three. Stand by one. One. Ready, six. Six. Stand by two. Two. Ready, one. One. Ready, four. Four. Ready, three. Actually, we'll go five. Five, you're up. Ready, two. Two. Ready, four. Four. Ready, one. One. Ready, six. Six. Ready, three. Three. Ready, five. Five. Get there, four. Stand by four. Four, you're up. Ready, one. One. Six. Go ahead and jump over to the Kelsey. Stand by three. Three. Ready, one. One. Six, jump over to Kelsey, far right. Stand by six, or stand by four. Four, ready, five. Five, ready, six. Six, ready, one. One, ready, ready, four. Four, ready, three. Three, stand by one. One, five, I have that over there if you want to jump on something else. Stand by two. Two, three. Stand by five. Five. Ready. One. One. Stand by four. Four. Here we go. Three. Build with them, guys. Three, you're up. Stand by one. One. Stand by four. Get it focused, Ari. Four, you're up. Stand by three. Or six. Six. Stand by one. We're gonna go two, actually. Two, you're up. Ready, four. Four. Ready, five. Five. Six, let's keep her on that left side. Stand by six. Six. Stand by three. Three, you're up. Ready, one. One. Stand by four. Four. Here we go. Two. Two. Ready, five. Five. Three. Three. Five, let's get the keys if you can. Stand by one. One. They're gonna play it out here. Stand by four, four, ready, five, five, stand by three, three. Nice and slow, three.
Next is Jess leaving.
Jess is leaving the next song, one, if you wanna jump over. Stand by five, five. Ready, six. Six. Ready, four. Four. Stand by three. three. Stand by one. One. Here we go, five. Five. Ready, four. Four, give me that shot again. Four, you're up. Ready, three. Three, four, you can start working your way towards drums. Ready, one. One. Ready, five. And five. Ready, four. Four. Ready, six. Six. Stand by three. Nice and smooth here. Three, you're up. Ready, five. Five, you're up. Ready, four. Four. Ready, one. And one. Ready, six. Six. Stand by three. Three, you're up. Ready, four. Hey, four, what if you got that low shot we were talking about? Stand by five. Five, you're up. Stand by four. Keep her on the left side. And four. Stand by six. Six. Ready, one. Stick with her six. Stand by five. Five, you're up. Stand by three. Or stand by four. Four. Three. Three. Stand by one. One, you're up. Stand by five. Five. Ready, four. Actually, ready, one. One, you're up. Stand by six. Six. Ready, four. Four, you're up. Stand by five. Here we go, five. Five, you're up. Stand by three. Three. Ready, six. Six. Stick with her, six. Keep her on the left side. Stand by one. One. Stand by four. Let's do it, four. You ready? Four, you're up. Ready, five. Five. Ready, one. One. Three. Three. Here we go, two, two. Stand by four, four. Ready, six, six. Ready, three, three. Nice and slow. Ready, five, five. Ready, one. Nice and smooth, one. One, you're up. Ready, two. Two. Ready, six. Six. Here we go, three. Three, you're up. Ready, four. Four. Ready, five. Five. Ready, one. One's up. Stand by, two. Watch your head room, two. Let's go down a little bit. Stand by, three. Three. Four, give me the drums. Stand by, five. Ready, five. Five, you're up. Ready, four. Four. Ready, one. One. Stand by six. Six. Stand by three. Three. Ready, four. Oh, ready, two. Two. Ready, one. One. Stand by three. Three. Ready, four. Here we go, four. Four, you're up. Stand by six and six. Ready, one. One. Five. Five. Four. Give me the drop. Get in there. Stand by four. And four. Ready, one. One. Ready, six. Six. Stand by three. Three. Ready, two. Two, you're up. You can come down a little bit. Stand by five. Five. Don't worry about the headroom in the back. Stand by three. Three. Four. Four, you're up. Stand by one. And one. Ready, six. Six, you're up. Stand by five. Five. Ready, three. Three. Ready, four. Four, ready, one, one, stand by two, two, ready, three, three, ready, six, six, stand by five, five, ready, one, one, three, actually, we're going to go six, six, you're up, stand by three, three, ready, four, ready, one,
should pray and seat us.
35, 5, 33, 3. One jump over Jala. Stand by one.
God, you are not just simply.
One, you're up. All right, three, get ready for a transition shot next.
God, you're in our present, working out.
Stand by six. Six.
You're a God who's active and on the move. And we have this living hope that far surpasses.
Ready, four, study that out.
God, may we cling to you.
Four, you're up.
May we run to
nice
you.
And steady.
When we place all the things that we carry in your arms.
One, you're up.
God, and may we point those around us.
Ready, three.
We love you, and it's in your son's
here
name.
Here we go, three. Nice and smooth.
Amen.
Three, you're up. One, be looking for
Ken is going Ken. To the center.
Stand by.
You may not realize it, but today is a special day. It's
brightness
national
a little bit on that.
Sunday.
Stand by one. Too bright, Mikey.
Now,
stand
if you're
by
not involved in adoption, if you don't
one's
have
up.
Adopted
in
children
room.
Or grandchildren, that may not mean a lot to you, but it should, because if you're in Christ, every one of us is adopted. Adopted into the family of God. And this day means a lot to me because I have three
ready,
adopted grandchildren. And we have one we're trying to adopt, a foster child. And
all right. One, you're going to be alive the whole time. I'm going to go to three on the internet campus.
My daughter and her husband are making a
three,
difference
you can start
in the lives
your move.
Of
nice
children
move.
Who need hope, who need help,
nice
who
move.
Need
here
a family
go.
That will love them. You know, Jesus or God says this in James chapter 1, verse 27. Pure and genuine religion in the sight of God the Father
one.
Means caring for orphans and widows in their distress. And we
one
take
cup.
That very seriously here at Christ Chapel. That's why
watch
we have
a
ministry
a little tight there.
Called His Child. And His Child comes along
no slide or anything for that, right?
Beside those who are being led to adopt and foster children by providing emotional and financial help because it's needed. It's costly. And your generosity makes that possible. And if you're someone who's thinking about adoption, fostering, we would love to come alongside you. And beginning next year, early this next year, we're going to be launching some special groups for adoptive and foster moms. And you can read more about that on the back of the sermon notes. It's an incredible ministry. It makes the difference in the lives of so many children. And it's hard. It's hard for those who are going through the process. And so your generosity, but also your prayers are desperately needed to continue that ministry. So if you'd like to give, you can give online. You can text the keyword up on the screen using your phone. Or, as always, you can give in one of the receptacles as you leave the sanctuary today. But continue to give and continue to pray for those who feel led by God to provide homes for those who don't have one. Would you pray with me? Well, Father, I thank
three.
You that every one of
go
us in
nice,
this room who are
move.
In Christ have been adopted into your
two,
family.
Two, get ready to set up that sermon shot we talked about.
And you have loved us, and you have bestowed on us grace
three,
and mercy
up.
And kindness and placed us in a loving family, the family of God, where
stand
we can
one.
Enjoy hope and help and healing. And Father, thank you for Christ Chapel. Thank you for those who
back to one.
Call themselves members of Christ Chapel who make it possible for His Child ministry to come alongside those who want to make the difference in the lives of children who need a home.
Stand by bumper.
And Father, raise up more. Raise up other individuals who would also step into that battle to pour into the lives of those who need help and true hope. And we pray all of this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
All right, rolling bumper.
Okay, I'm watching the stage.
The table.
I don't think right, he
two?
Got the pick that he fell.
If you can get that shot set
place
up
for me.
As quick as possible. Wait for that podium. It's going to come out. Be looking for it.
It's coming out.
Games.
And then, Mikey, can you give two as much light as
ordinary
possible? It's the first time she's ever set this
that
up.
Holds
so
something sacred.
Gain that up
okay,
and then get ready to bring it right
pick.
Back down.
Chairs creaky. Forks scrape.
All right. Hang on. I think you're going to end up zooming
love.
Just a tiny bit.
Stories unfold.
As soon as Cody stands up. Yeah, let's zoom in a little bit. A little
okay.
bit. And tilt down. Right there.
Silence.
Zoom out just a tiny bit.
Place for prayers.
Tilt down.
Peace you wish would never end.
The
table is witness.
Yep, I think you're good right there.
Tonight we'll always remember.
So just lean back, relax.
It's where if we look close, we find God's heart. pour it out.
Tell if it's in focus. Stand by one. Ready, one.
Well, hello, Christ One's Chapel, up. And welcome to all of you at our West
two.
Campus, South Campus, Hive,
yeah, two, you're good.
Converge, and of course, our internet campus. What a great day it is to worship the Lord together. I have to start off by first saying tip of the cap to the Horn Frogs. Great
Stand
win
by three.
For you yesterday.
Let's zoom in.
Big win. Yeah, that was a big one. Man, Chandler Morris played out of his mind. But even a bigger tip of the cap
three, let's
to
zoom all the way into
the
Cody.
Veterans.
Is that your focus?
Thursday is Veterans Day, and we are so thankful for the service
two is
that
still too bright,
you have
Mikey.
Given
yep.
To our country and to us. So thank you very much. Yeah.
Set your focus to Cody there, Kevin.
Okay, I want to take you back a little bit to a movie that came out in the 90s. It was called 10 Things I Hate About You.
Okay.
I know you're
right
thinking
there,
that sounds like an awful
zoom
movie.
Let's zoom all the way to him. Like
a romantic
as you can get
comedy
it. Now
based
set focus,
on Shakespeare's
then you can zoom
Taming
out.
Of the Shrew, and it's set in a high school setting.
There you go, yeah.
And actually,
out,
a quote in
right
that
there.
Movie
let's
that
see what
I
this
will
looks like.
Never
go ahead and start
forget.
Sliding whenever you're ready.
Pretty much nothing to do with the movie, but these two girls are walking
yep.
out of the
a little
school,
bit slower for this. So this one's gonna be real slow compared to what we just did.
To the other, she says. I know you can
Start
be
sliding.
Underwhelmed, and you can be overwhelmed, but can
Freeze
you
up.
Just be, like, whelmed? To which the other girl says, I think you can in Europe.
Stand by one.
I never forgot that quote,
One's up.
Obviously,
right, Kevin, you just
because I've
setup.
Pontificated on that a lot. Can you just be whelmed? We all know what it's like to feel overwhelmed. We all know what it's like to be overwhelmed. But can you just be whelmed? It's a great question. And as I thought about that question, I thought, no, it is impossible to be whelmed because to be whelmed means that you are devoid of expectations. It's to live without
right,
any
three,
expectations about anything that will take place or go on. And we have expectations for
three,
everything in our lives. You can't go to
nice
a restaurant.
There,
you can't go to a movie. You can't wake up in the morning without an expectation
one.
Of how your day is going to
Can
go.
Clear?
You are going to have an expectation and either be overwhelmed or underwhelmed. And the same is true not just for everyday life, but for our Christian life as well. You have expectations about what it means to follow Jesus. And you sometimes are overwhelmed by what that means. Sometimes you're overwhelmed in a great way. Sometimes you're overwhelmed in a negative way. And sometimes we don't have the right expectations of what it means to follow Jesus, which makes us be overwhelmed in our world today. And when we don't have those right expectations and we're overwhelmed by what it feels like to live for Him in our world today, we can be very underwhelmed in our walk with Jesus. We've got to have the right expectations of what it means to follow Jesus and the experiences
okay.
that we'll have
Stand
in our
three.
World so we're neither overwhelmed
nice,
nor underwhelmed, but just whelmed. So if you will, open your Bibles to John chapter 15. John chapter 15, we're going to start
right
in
there.
Verse 18. We're going to continue
right.
our series called
okay.
Poured Out, where we're looking at Jesus pouring out his heart to his disciples the night before he would be betrayed and therefore crucified. And remember, we're studying this portion
Mike,
of John's gospel because
about three
we want to
like
embody
it.
His heart.
Down just a
That's
tiny
why
bit.
Jesus is pouring his heart
Brightness
into
wise.
His disciples is because they will be his representatives on the earth. And we want to be
yeah,
his
like
representatives
Thank
on
you.
The earth, but specifically so that we can reach those in our own backyard who don't know the love of Christ. And so we want to embody his heart. So that's why we're looking at this portion of scripture where he pours
right,
out his
three,
heart into his disciples. And last week specifically, we looked at John chapter 15, where we saw that Jesus is pouring his heart
You're
into his disciples so that they will bear his fruit. That means that they will look like him. Remember, he is the vine and we are the branches. Apart from him, we can do nothing. So if we're connected to him, we will look like him.
One,
and guess what? If
Good
we
job,
look
really
like
nice.
Him, we will be treated like him. And that's what he's going to begin to explain to his disciples at this last part of John chapter 15 and even going into chapter 16. So what I want to do is read a couple of portions here. So I want you to follow along with me. And I want to read John chapter 15 verses 18 to 21. Then we're going to skip and I want to read chapter 16 verses 1 through 4. So follow along with me. Jesus tells his disciples, if the world hates you, know that it has hated me even before it hated you. If you were of the world, then the world would love you as its own. But because you are not of the world, but I chose you out of the world, therefore the world hates, actively hates you. Remember the word that I said to you. A servant is not greater than his master. If they persecuted me, guess what? They will also persecute you. If they kept my word, then they'll keep yours. But all these things they will do to you on account of my name, because they do not know him who sent me. I'll go to 16, verse 1.
Stand by 3.
I have said all these things to you to keep you from falling away. They will put you out of the synagogues. Indeed, the hour is coming when whoever kills you will think he is offering service to God. And they will do these things because they have not known the Father nor me. But I have said these things to you, that when their hour comes, you may remember that I told them to you. And may God bless
the reading of his word. May our hearts be open to hear from him. It looks
and so what
too good
Jesus is trying to do in this portion of John is he's trying to adjust the disciples' expectation of how they will be treated in this world. If you'll remember, we've talked about this in the first couple of weeks. The disciples walked into that upper room with Jesus to celebrate the Passover feast with completely different expectations about what would happen the next few hours. Remember, they walked into Jerusalem thinking that they were about to rule and reign with Jesus, that Jesus was going to overthrow the Roman government and he would establish his kingdom. And remember, we used Luke chapter 22 as context, and the disciples were arguing about who would be the greatest in the kingdom. They were arguing about who was going to sit on his right and who is going to be on his left. Who are going to have the positions of prominence and power? And Jesus is like, yeah, that's not what I'm doing. I'm not doing it the way that you think I'm going to do it. And so Jesus begins to adjust their expectations. And he wants to adjust them to say, hey, guys, the way that the world treats me, they're going to treat you that way. And he's adjusting their expectations so that they wouldn't fall away. That's what he says in John chapter 16, verse 1. I have said all these things to you to keep you from falling away. That word falling away is a super interesting word. The Greek word is skandalizo. It's where we get our word scandal from. And what it means is, it's a trap that is set. The imagery is like a rabbit trap, something that snares an animal. And what Jesus is saying is, I don't want you to be caught in a trap, to stumble or be ensnared because you didn't expect how hard it would be.
Good job.
The disciples want to say, hey, I didn't sign up to be hated. And guess what? Probably none of you did either. You didn't say, Jesus, if there's a hate group, a group that wants to be hated, I'll be a part of that one. No, nobody wants to sign up for that. But Jesus said, guys, you've got to have a realistic expectation of how the world sees you so that you don't fall into this trap and you aren't ensnared and therefore fall away from me. And remember, falling away, go back to John chapter 5, or 15 verse 5, go back to our memory verse, apart from him you can do nothing. So if you fall away, you're not connected to him, you cannot bear his fruit. You won't experience the abundant life in Jesus that he wants you to experience. So he's trying to adjust their expectations, that if they bear his fruit, they will be treated like him. And so what I want to do today is I want to prepare us the same way that Jesus was trying to prepare his disciple, that if we look like Jesus, we will be treated like Jesus by the world, and hopefully adjust some of our expectations, even help you understand why we're treated that way, give you some applications. And then at all of our venues, we're going to be celebrating communion. So if you're on the internet campus, please go ahead and get those supplies together. So let's look at these first couple of verses, because I want you to see the way that Jesus is going to encourage his disciples is by telling them that what you'll experience from the world, he has already been through. He wants to encourage them. And that's been my prayer for you this entire week, is that this would be the most encouraging sermon about hate that you've ever heard. I want you to be encouraged. And Jesus wants to encourage his disciples that, hey, even though you're going to be hated, guess what? I've been there before. They hated me first. In fact, that's what he says in chapter 15, verse 18. If the world hates you, know that it's hated me before it hated you. Now, the question that you should be asking here is, why does the world hate Jesus? What I hope that you know about Jesus is his mission statement. His mission statement, he says it very succinctly and plainly in Luke chapter 19, verse 10, that Jesus came to seek and to save the lost. He came to sacrifice himself as a substitute for our sins so that we would be saved from eternal hell and damnation. I mean, you go, here is our hero. Here is our Savior who's showing up to save the day. Why would anybody hate him? The reason why the world hates him is because he is reflecting back to them as a mirror their own wickedness. That's why they don't want anything to do with him. In fact, he says that in John chapter 7, verse 7. He says, the world hates me because I testify that its works are evil. I'm a mirror. I am reflecting back to the world that they're evil, that they're not righteous. My name is Joel. That's awesome. And the world doesn't like seeing that. The world doesn't like hearing that. And that's why they wanted to crucify him. You see, there's an understanding that you have to have about the world, and all of this is on your sermon notes. But I want you to understand the perspective that the world has. You see, the way that Jesus is talking about the world here is, the world is an organized system of society that is hostile toward God. That's what he means here by the world. He's not talking about the physical earth. The word that is used here is cosmos. He's not talking about the stars and the sun and the moon. He's talking about this organized system that is hostile toward God. That we even know that Satan is in charge of that organized system. That God, in his sovereign, permissive will, has allowed Satan to rule the world, this organized system that is hostile toward him. And I know that'll blow some of your minds. But that's why this world that he's talking about hates Jesus. It's because it's anti everything God is. I read a commentator that said it this way, and I think it's very good. The world involves philosophies, activities, organizations, and ideologies that spring from a place that wants to establish a life apart from God's rule and reign, that clothes itself in hatred toward God in sophistication, refinement, culture, and progress. It is a system that is set up that doesn't want anything to do with God. And this is nothing new. Look back at Genesis chapter 9 and the Tower of Babel. Humanity wanted to do something apart from God so that they would be God themselves. God, we know how to do it better than you do. And so we will do it our own way, our own self. And then you know in Romans chapter 1, that's where God says, I'll turn you over to your own desires then. You think you can do it? And obviously it just goes down the tubes. You see, world doesn't want anything to do with God, and that's why it does not acknowledge the words
and works of God. Are these the ones he said he's going to click through?
God. In a part that we skipped there in verse 24, Jesus says, look, I have done amazing works among them, and they don't want to acknowledge them.
Yeah.
I came to show them that I was the one that could save them,
well,
that
made it sound
I
you wouldn't
am
even take
God.
Them out,
and they don't want to acknowledge it, and they don't want to listen to me because they want to do
mean,
it
if he's
their
this long,
own
yeah.
way, all by themselves. They won't even acknowledge the work of God. That's why Jesus ends in verse 25 by saying the world hates God without a logical cause. I want you to see that. Look at verse 25. If you have your Bible.
All right,
number
three. Let's get a
it
nice
says,
move
but the
here.
Word that is written in their law must be fulfilled. And this is a quote from Psalm
nice study. Here we go.
Chapter, Psalm
up.
69, verse 4. It says, they hated me without a cause.
All right, stand by one. And
that resonates with me.
Back to one.
Because I think we oftentimes have the mindset that if we treat people in a kind way, then what do we expect in return? Kindness. And I think that's logical, right? We think what we give, we should receive. But what we've got to remember is the world hated Jesus without cause. You see, the way that the world treats Jesus is not logical, it's theological. They don't want anyone ruling or reigning over them. They don't want to submit their will to anyone, much less their creator God. They don't want to live under his rule and reign. And that's important, I think, for us to understand that the world hated him first and without logical cause. And you say, why is that encouraging? I think it's encouraging because what Jesus is saying is, wherever you're going to go, I have been before. Whatever way that you're treated, they've already treated me that way. I am a guide who's gone before you. And I think that's super encouraging. A few summers ago, Jen and I took the boys on a little rafting trip in New Mexico. And thankfully, there was a guide that was going to be in the boat. It wasn't just, or the little raft, it wasn't just up to me to guide down the river. And so in talking to the guide,
nice, number three.
What do you think one of the first questions I asked him was?
Nice and smooth, here
Have
we go.
Have you done this before? Right? You know, I'm about to put my family in this guy's raft. Have you gone down this river before? And of course, he assured me he's done it plenty of times.
Stand
and
by
it
one.
Was very pleasant and calm. It was great. Because he had gone before.
What's up?
And that's assuring to me that, hey, it doesn't matter what I'm looking at ahead. Even if it's to be hated for Jesus' sake, I have a Savior who's gone before me, who leads me, and who has been there, done that, who knows and can sympathize and empathize with how we are treated. So he encourages his disciples that he was hated first, and then he warns his disciples. He says, hey, expect that the world will hate you. Why? So you won't be surprised and fall away. So that you don't fall into this trap. You expect that if you're nice to people and you love them and you just want to share truth with them, that they should be nice and receive it as well. And he goes, no, don't expect that. If you expect that, you're going to get caught in a trap of expectations. You'll be overwhelmed by the way that they treat you. In fact, he says this in verse 18. He says, if the world hates you. And you go, good, if. No. That's a conditional clause that assumes a positive response, meaning it's not if, it's when.
I'm putting this down.
When the world hates you. And then he goes on in verses 19 and 20.
I could have just left it up.
He says,
that was my fault.
If you were of the world, then the world would love you as its own. But because you are not of this world, but I chose you out of the world, therefore the world hates you. Remember the word that I said to you? A servant is not greater than his master. If they persecuted me, don't you think they'll persecute you? If they kept my word, then they'll also keep yours. Jesus brings back around. Sure. That should be familiar to you, this a servant is not greater than his master. Do you remember where you heard that before?
No. I heard you wrong. You definitely said it right.
John chapter 13, remember?
Stand by 3.
John chapter 13, when Jesus is washing their feet. And he said, a servant is not greater than his master. So he's telling them that because if you're following in my ways, then you will love one another the way that I love you. He's using that as an example of how we should treat one another. Now he takes the same phrase and he uses it in not how we treat others, but how we will be treated by others. A servant's not greater than his master. If they mistreated me and you're living like me, don't you think they will mistreat you? Christian, let me say this. The more you look like him, the more you will be mistreated. The more you will be hated. And for some of you, that is a collision of desires. And I get it. Because you say, Cody, I want to look like Jesus. Like, I want to follow him. But I don't want to be hated. And that's why he assures them, guys, you don't belong to this world. This is not all you're living for. The world, as he describes it here, this is all they have. But I chose you out of this world. You're not of this world. You don't belong to this world. You see, everything that we represent shows that we don't belong here. You see, we're not a part of this organized system that's hostile toward God. Now we have been brought out, set apart, and chosen. Christians are a new organism with an altered allegiance to God.
That's fine.
We're not an organization. We are now a new organism, the body of Christ, where we all have a part.
You're up.
Where we are now alive in him, and we have a new allegiance. We do not have our primary allegiance to anyone but him.
One's up.
We don't put up an allegiance. See, in the world, and you understand this, in a world, an allegiance shifts all the time. It's who do I have to be to whom? And if my boss says this and break the law a little bit, fudge on this, then my allegiance has to be to him. And if this person says to do this, then I'll fudge and I'll do that. And my allegiance shifts all the time. Now we say our allegiance is to him first and foremost, which plays into the second thing, that Christians allow God's authoritative teaching to guide their words and works. This is our authority. What God says, the Bible says. What the Bible says, God says. We don't shift on public opinion. We don't say whatever the world begins to say, we'll drift and follow that so that we can fit in. God has chosen us out of the world to stand out, just like he stood out. And when we live by his word and stand on his truth, we do stand out like a sore thumb. We're supposed to because we look like him. You see, Christians reflect an illogical relationship to the world. The world does not understand a Christian's perspective. Why? Because we are in the world, but we are not of the world. And those prepositions matter a ton. Yes, we're in the world. We're here. Yes. But as he says, we don't belong to the world. Don't forget what Paul says in 1 Corinthians chapter 6. He says, you are not your own. You were bought with a price. Therefore, honor God with your bodies. We're called to, that's the new allegiance that we have because we have been redeemed. That's what redeemed means, is bought back. Bought back from the world. We don't belong to the world anymore. And the world doesn't understand how to relate to us. Like, what? I don't get it, Christian. You have a different set of values. You have a different set of marching orders. You don't just simply do what it takes to fit in. You always stand out. You don't act like the rest of the world. It's an illogical relationship because this is not all we have. We look forward to what is to come. And to those in the world, you understand how I'm using that, this is all they got. This is it. That's why there's this illogical relationship. And so Jesus tells his disciples, expect to be mistreated. Expect it. If you don't expect it, then you'll fall into the trap. We understand that. Our expectations have everything to do with our emotions. And I wish we could be devoid of expectations, but you can't. And so because we bear fruit, because we are connected to the vine as his branches, bear his fruit, look like him, we will be mistreated and misunderstood just like Jesus was. And that's okay. Because let me remind you too, I just told you about John chapter 13. Don't forget where he uses that phrase, a servant's not greater than his master. What does he follow that up with? Love one another. See, we're supposed to encourage and help one another along the way. To remind one another, yes, we do have an illogical relationship with this world. It doesn't make sense, but hey, brother, sister, we look forward to what's to come. And we're going to encourage one another to persevere. But we don't just have to help one another. Jesus gives us another helper. You see, Jesus assured his disciples, you won't be alone and you'll be empowered, actually, to imitate him. He doesn't leave us alone. And I love that part of that passage that he talks about in John chapter 14, where in verse 18, where he says, I won't leave you alone as orphans.
Stand by three. Three, go ahead and start your move.
That's why he puts us as part of this new organism, the body of Christ, but he also indwells us by his Spirit for all of you who have placed your trust in him. He gives us the Holy Spirit. He says that in verses 26 and 27 of chapter 15.
Scripture then.
But when the Helper comes, whom I will send to you from the Father, the Spirit of truth who proceeds from the Father, he will bear witness about me. Same word as bear fruit. And you also will bear witness because you have been with me from the beginning. The Holy Spirit empowers us to imitate Jesus, to live like him. And that's a powerful thing. It should be a powerful thing. So much so, let me give you an example. Because think about the disciples. When Jesus goes to the cross the next day, how many disciples are around him? Goose egg.
That's funny.
All of them fall away. All of them.
Three, go ahead and go.
And they're holed up in this room in Jerusalem until Acts chapter 2, when what happens? Holy Spirit comes.
Three's up.
And when the Holy Spirit comes and indwells them as believers in Jesus, what do they begin to do?
Stand by one.
They begin to testify about him. I mean, this is exactly what happens in Acts chapter 2. The Holy Spirit comes, they begin to bear witness, and the world is on fire for Jesus. 3,000 people come to know him that day because they bear witness about him. The Holy Spirit does not, it indwells us. Jesus says, I'm not going to leave you alone, but I am going to empower you to imitate me and bear witness for me in this world. To endure this hatred from the world. Because, folks, the world could list more than 10 things they hate about us. And that's okay. It's okay. The more you are hated, the more you look like him. That's why I said, I want this to be the most encouraging sermon on hate you've ever heard. It's illogical. I know it doesn't make any sense. But the more you're hated, the more you look like him. And folks, that's the way that our world is going. It's the way that our country is going. We should not expect that they would accept Christian values. Why? There's no reason to expect that. What Jesus sets up for his disciples is the world is going to hate you if you look like me. So bear witness for me. So let me give you three very quick applications of how we should apply this, knowing that we'll be hated. The first is this. Don't compromise your witness for Jesus by conforming to a world you do not belong to. Don't compromise your witness for Jesus by conforming to a world that you do not belong to. The temptation that exists is that if, and man, I share
all right, restart
this,
your move.
Okay? I'm not preaching at you. I am preaching for us, myself included.
All right, you're up.
If I know that I'm going to be hated for something, my temptation is to shrink back or to blend in, to soften that blow. I want to blend in. I don't want to stand out.
Back to one.
But we cannot conform to the world. We cannot look like the world. Folks, you cannot two-time Jesus. It's as simple as that. You can't flirt with the world and flirt with Jesus. Scripture says our God is a jealous God. And in some ways, I used to not understand that. And it makes God sound like a narcissist in some ways. Like he just wants your full attention. And guess what? He does. Because guess what? The world is just as jealous for your affection. And the more that you follow the world, the more you're ensnared and entrapped and not experiencing life. And that's why he's jealous for you, is because he bought you back. You've been bought with a price, and he wants you to experience the life that he paid for in full. And so for some of you, it's time to DTR with Jesus. It's time for you to define the relationship. You need to make a commitment to him. And maybe today is the day that you do that and draw the line in the sand. And you say, oh, I'm confused. You know, I don't know who I like more, the world or Jesus. No, you're just trying to confuse both. You're not confused. You just don't want to commit. Trust me, I did Life Stage 2 ministry plenty, okay? It's time to stand
all right, three, you
up for
move.
Him and to make a commitment. And here's why. I want to tell you a very sobering thing that Jesus says in Matthew chapter 10, which we'll study later on in the new year. But in Matthew chapter 10, he says this, for those of you considering a DTR with Jesus today. So everyone who acknowledges me before men, I also will acknowledge before my Father who is in heaven. But whoever denies me before men, I will deny before my Father in heaven. That is sobering. See, some of us are afraid of the guilt by association that comes from following Jesus. But let me be very clear. If you experience guilt by association with Jesus on earth, then you will experience glory by association in heaven. They both go together. And I know you want to experience glory by association with Jesus. And so sometimes it's guilt by association here. But we can't compromise. You can't go back and forth. Don't flirt with the world and Jesus. Second, don't isolate yourself from a world that needs to see God's heart incarnate. Another temptation that we have is that if we know we're going to be hated, if we stepped into that, we'll just retreat. This is the monastic movement. We'll just shine the light of Jesus right here in our home. We got our ticket. Nobody else has to see it. This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine in my bedroom. And Jesus says, no. The world needs to see that. How is the world going to see that? And you say, hold on, Cody, but then like I'm going to be
hated.
Right,
three, go ahead, start your move.
You know what? And that may be the way that they see Jesus.
Nice move. Here we go.
A mentor a long time ago gave me a great illustration. And he said, and I've used this before, but this applies here, of Cody, we're all like sponges.
Stand by one.
Nobody knows what's inside until we're squeezed. And it's true. And sometimes that's why we're left in the world, is because the world's going to squeeze you and they're going to see Jesus. Jesus is about to go to the cross and he's going to be squeezed for our sins. And what does he say on the cross? Father, forgive them. They don't know what they do. And there are people at the foot of the cross who put their faith in him because they see what happens when he's squeezed. we can't isolate ourselves and say, I don't want to be squeezed. That hurts. It does. But you're not left alone. And there's going to be great fruit that comes from you being squeezed for him. And then third, don't hate the world or retaliate, because God loves transforming his enemies into his children. Do not miss this. Don't hate the world or retaliate, because God loves transforming his enemies into children.
What an amateur.
Let me say this, Christ Chapel.
All right, guys, we have one more scripture, and then he's going to be wrapping up.
It is one thing to endure persecution, and it's another thing to pick a fight.
So four and five, you can kind of wait to get out on the stage until
we are called to endure persecution because we look like Jesus, not because we treat people like jerks. And when we bear his fruit, we're going to be hated. And what we want to do is we want to retaliate and hate in response. And we want to go, oh, you want to call me nasty words? I'll call you nasty words. And you want to bump up again? I'll bump right back. And you go, hold on, is that Christ-like? Is that what Jesus would do? He doesn't call us to hate the world. And the reason why he doesn't call us to hate the world is because he loves the world. Isn't that the verse that I hope that we've all memorized and put deep down in our heart, that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whoever believes in him will not perish but have everlasting life. Loved him so much that he gave his only son because he wanted to see his enemies transformed into his children. And guess what? You are evidence of that transformation. Because you and I were all enemies of him. We all wanted to rebel against Jesus. We all wanted to go our own way. And we all hated God. And the only way that cycle was broken was when Jesus laid down his life for us and loved us first. You see, folks, we in our world, we are in this cycle of hate. And the only way that that cycles is it spirals down the drain. And the only way to break that cycle is to love. It's the only way. It's the way that Jesus broke the cycle, and it's the way that we break the cycle.
All right.
So be encouraged. Expect it. It's okay. The more you're mistreated, the more you look like him. You're empowered to imitate him. And so I leave you with what Jesus said, which we'll study later on in the Sermon on the Mount. You've heard it said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, so that you may be sons and daughters of your Father who is in heaven. Would you pray with me?
It's out.
God, thank you.
All right, three, you can set up to a
to set right expectations for us.
Yep.
And giving us the expectation that if we look like you, we'll be treated like
you. I don't have you yet, no.
Lord, I know you don't want us to be mistreated.
I don't know, you might just be looking at I got you.
You don't want that for us. That's why you tell us this.
No.
That you don't leave
You're
us
marking alone. On the amen.
You give us the Holy Spirit.
Stand by three. I'm going to go to you as soon as he says amen.
To empower us to persevere, Lord God. May we be a church that when we're hated on account of you,
I'll take it out
when
the
we're
room.
Squeezed,
actually,
that people would see you
we won't take it
and
out
come
room.
To know you. Help us to love our enemies and pray for those who persecute us.
Yes, I will. I'll
we
bring it back.
Live
once
in your
we're
name,
set up.
Just as we
Stand by three.
In your name. Amen.
Three's up. One, jump over. Stand by
well,
one.
We want to continue in worship as
Ready,
we
one.
Celebrate
One's
the
up.
Table together. I hope by now you've made the connection that all the imagery that's been up on the screens and the video that we watch before every sermon Cody preaches is about the table. That's the connection. You see, it's around that table in that upper
room. All right,
three,
I'm going to use you during this too.
Jesus
you can
zoom
shared in just a tiny bit.
A meal with his disciples. It's where he
Careful,
announced
everyone.
That one of them would betray him. And I've always thought it's fascinating that, you know, we sometimes refer to this as the Lord's Supper. You know, I grew up in the church, and I remember as a kid watching my parents take the Lord's Supper and wondered why it was so small. It's not much of a meal, is it? A little piece of bread and a little cup of juice. But see, it's not about the meal. It's about the message behind the meal. And so as we prepare to take the Lord's table together, I want us to think about the fact that around that table, when Jesus gathered with his disciples, he gave them a message. A message of, yes, his coming death, but behind that message was the message of hope, the message of love, the message of transformation. So while the meal may appear small, it's incredibly significant. And that's why we shouldn't take it lightly. Cody referenced John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his son. He made the ultimate sacrifice.
Nice and slow.
So that you and I might enjoy freedom from sin and a place around that table. If you've never thought about it, think about it today, that you have a place at the table, not because you deserved it, not because you earned it, but because Jesus Christ loved to the end, to the cross.
All right, four and five. Because of that,
we as sinners can come to that table fully forgiven.
Another one that we thought starting on drums and keys would be really good.
Listen to what Paul says in Ephesians chapter 2.
Try to get those shots set pretty quickly.
You were living apart from Christ. You were excluded from citizenship among the people of Israel, and you did not know the covenant promises God had made to them. You lived in this world without God and without hope. But now, you have been united with Christ Jesus. Once you were far away from God, but now you've been brought near to him through the blood of Christ. The blood of Christ is the only reason we can come near to Christ and be seated with him at the table, covered in his righteousness imparting blood. That's the significance of this little meal. And it was around that table that night that Jesus took bread. Not a full meal, but just some bread.
Stand by one.
And with it, he conveyed a message. When he had given thanks, he broke the bread and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Take and eat. Then Jesus reached down and he picked up a cup of wine and said, "This is the cup, the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Take and drink.
Three, you're up.
What's interesting is he took that very same cup and he passed it around to the disciples, and each one drank from the same cup. There wasn't enough wine in there to slack their thirst, but there was enough wine to convey the message. He says, "For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes."
Let's try to start some movement on that shot. So
you see, it's not the size of the meal.
Figure out where you might be heading.
It's the significance of the message. One of my favorite books in the Bible is the book of Revelation. And one of my favorite verses is at the very end of the book where Jesus says to John these words, "Surely I am coming soon."
All right, three. You start setting
up
for a
transition. I love the response of John. He says, "Amen."
Just a little bit wider.
Come,
tilt
Lord
up
Jesus.
And zoom in just a tiny bit.
Would you pray with me?
I'm going to take him out of the room while he's praying.
Well, along with the Apostle John, I pray, "Amen. Come, Lord Jesus." We long to see this sin-darkened world lit up by the glory of your presence, Lord. We can't wait to see your kingdom
come.
Let's
have some fun with this last one. Let's finish strong. It's looked good.
But while
we
wait for
really
the promise
job, so.
Of your return, would you help us to stay focused on fulfilling our commission?
Stand by three.
We are your ambassadors, Lord. And you have called us to carry your message of reconciliation to a lost and dying world. And we may suffer as a result because you suffered. Help us to remember that your body was not broken just for us alone. Your blood wasn't poured out just for us alone. There is plenty of room at your table. But how will they come if they aren't invited?
Stand by one.
Like Andrew, may we seek out the Simons of the world and joyfully
One's
tell
up.
Them we
right.
have found
Get set up for the
Simon.
Transition. Here we go.
And we pray this in his holy, matchless name.
Stand by three.
Amen.
Three is up. Marcus is leading this far left. One, yeah. if you want to get over there. Stand by five. Five, start your move. Five, you're up. Three, four. Four. Six, let's zoom out just a little bit. Stand by one. One, you're up. Four, you're still up. Didn't call you off. One, you're up. Stand by three. Three, you're up. Ready, six. Ready, five. Five, you're up. Four. Ready, three. Three. Ready, one. Actually, ready, four, let's do that. Ready? Four, you're up. You kind of slowly bring it down, Whistle. Stand by five. Five. Three. Three. Ready, six. Six. Ready, four. Four, you're up. Five, let's get to the keys. Stand by three. Three. Ready, six. Ready, one. One. Six, let's change it up a little bit. Stand by five. Five. Ready, four. Four. Ready, one. Ready, one, and one. Hang on there, Colton. Stand by three. Three, you're up. Stand by six. Six. Ready, five. Five. Ready, three. Three, you're up. Ready, one. One. Stand by four. Four. Ready, three. And three. Stand by five. Ready, five. Five. Ready, six. Six. Ready, one. One. Three. Three, you're up. Stand by two. Two. Here we go, six. Six. Ready, one. One. Ready, four. Four. Ready, five. Five, you're up. Stand by three. Three. Ready, four. Get it, four. Four, you're up. Ready, one. One. Ready, five. Five. Ready, three. Three, ready, six, six, ready, four, ready, three, three, stand by one, one, ready, four,
he shall come
nope. ready, five,
with trumpet sound.
Five,
oh, may
ready,
I
three,
in him be found.
Three, ready, four, four, stand by one. One. Stand by two. Two. Ready, three. Three. Stand by five. Five. Ready, four. Ready, three. Three, go. Yep. Three, you're up. One, ready six. Six, you're up. Stand by four. Four, ready one. One, ready two. Two, three. Three, ready four. Four, ready one. One, ready five. Five, ready six. Six, Stand by three, three. Ready four, four. Ready one, one. Ready four, or two. We're gonna go three. Three, you're up. Ready one, one. Ready six, six. Ready five, five. Ready four, four, you're up. Ready one, one. Stand by three, three, you're up. Stand by six, six. Ready one, one. Here we go, four. Four, you're up. Stand by three. Three, you're up. Ready one, one. Ready five, five. Ready one, ready two, two. Ready four, four. Ready three, three. Nice big transition here. Slow it down a little bit, three. One, be looking for Cody. Stand by
Cody's
one.
Cody's going in.
Quick, it's quick.
Amen. What an encouragement. I hope this has been my prayer. I hope the Lord answered my prayer. This has been the most encouraging sermon in time where we've talked about
Should
hate.
Be in the room.
Not usually encouraging to cool. talk about hate, but man, when you know that.
Good job, guys. We got to tear that stage down pretty quick.
That's encouraging to me, and I hope it's encouraging to you if you're a guest. Thank you so much for choosing to spend a part of your weekend with us. We'd love to get to know you more. And
so
even
let's
give
all
you
try to meet up on that right
maybe
side.
In your walk with Christ,
we'll get that right side pulled down as fast as possible.
In your relationship with us as a church.
And we'll get it flipped over to
the kiosk.
Good job, everyone.
Outside in the great room, you'll see a screen that looks just like that. And there will be a pastor that can answer any questions that you might have about our church. And if you need prayer for anything, man, remember, we are here to love one another, to pray for one another, to support each other. Maybe you are being hated and you're being squeezed and you want prayer for that, to endure through that time. We'd love to be able to pray for you. We'll have some folks up here at the front to be able to pray for you before you go today. So don't walk out burdened in any way, please. But I hope that you remember this week that you are empowered to imitate him by the power of the Holy Spirit. And when we live according to him, he sets the world on fire. And that's the world that we don't belong to because we belong to him. Amen? Amen. God bless you. We love you. We'll see you next week.